Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Sean Hudgenwortel, and I will be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles. They are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce a sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name given of our Father, and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this selfsame spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world erroneously calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today, our scripture lesson will be Romans chapter 4, and that will be read by Dr. Bud Wunsch. Our prayer will be by Dr. Samuel Salas, and we will have that followed by a selection of music. Here, let me help you. It's right there.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
It's time of prayer. It's but our heart and mind. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for giving us another day of learning your purpose and plan of salvation, which is the goal of our the souls living in this earth. Also, thank you for all the good things you give us in life, for our pleasure and for living in peace, harmony, and loving in our brothers. I say all those things in your only sign name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
This mountain so high I could not climb, for every step that I would take forward, Satan put me 3 steps behind them. There was this river, so deep I thought I'd drown. Then a voice touched my soul so gently. It was Yahshua. When I cried out, he said, "Peace, be still, child, and let me lift you over." He said, "Peace, be still, child, let me make you my soldier for truth." Towards
Good morning, class.
Morning.
This morning we will be reading the fourth chapter of Romans, taken out of the Holy Name Bible. Not a King James or a Dowie, it's the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, and revised by A. B. Trina of the Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. This particular Bible was reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. Romans, the fourth chapter. What shall we say then that Abraham our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found? For if Abraham was justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before Yahweh. For what saith the Scriptures? Abraham believed Yahweh, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Now to him that worketh, it is the reward not reckoned by grace, but by debt, or of debt. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the unrighteousness, his faith is counted for righteousness. Even as David also describeth the blessings of the man, unto whom Yahweh imputeth righteousness, spirit from works, saying, Blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven, and those sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom Yahweh will not impute sin. Cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision only, or upon the uncircumcision only? For we sayeth that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. How then? Reckoned, when he was in circumcision or in uncircumcision? Not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision. And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had yet been uncircumcised, but that he might be the father of all them that believe, though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also. And the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had being yet uncircumcised. For the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham, or to his seed, through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. For if they which are of the law be heirs, faith is made void, and the promise made of none effect. Because the law worketh wrath, for where no law is, there is no transgression. Therefore it is of faith, that it might be by grace to the end of the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of all. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations. Before him who he believed, even Yahweh, who quickeneth the dead and calleth those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, but considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb, he staggered not at all the promise of Yahweh through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to Yahweh. And being fully persuaded that he had promised, he was also to perform. And therefore it was imputed to him for righteousness. Now it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Yahshua our Savior from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. That was Romans, the fourth chapter. Let us all say,
thank you, Dr. Salas, and thank you, Dr. Wunsch. Today is Sunday. We will have a lecture format today. For our first speaker for today's class, I would like to call on the president of the Ontario branch, Dr. Christopher Williams. Dr. Williams.
Good morning again, class.
Good morning.
As always, it's an honor to stand before you as a son of Yahshua Messiah to impart unto you some of the things I've come to know and learn since being in this great gospel. I don't know about you. I can listen to you read all day long. I mean, even when you mess up, it sounds graceful. I'd be damned. But you got a gift. I mean, you got a face for TV and a voice for radio. I mean, heaven help me. You should, man, that was great. I went to school with a person that they would ask us to read. Nobody put their hand up. We just let her do it because she was so good at it. But, man, that was excellent. So Sean originally asked me, hey, you want to carry the class? I'm like, nope. And then I saw what we were reading. I'm like, dagnabbit. It's like y'all would say, you're going to get your butt up there and talk today. Because I had already figured I'm going to spend some time in Romans. Because I wanted to address the carnal mind. And since we're talking about circumcision in the scripture, maybe I might as well just kind of talk about it all. But there was a question asked, and I want to try to address that at the same time as well. So since we're talking about Abraham and how he's the father of faith, and how it was mentioned that he is the father of us all, that needs to be explained, and then hopefully we can talk about all of this. But, you know, just remember that whatever we do discuss, it's always about Yahshua the Messiah. And we're not talking about anything outside of that. And I don't want us to get caught up in the flesh or in our carnality where we think that it's something outside of Yahshua himself that we're referring to. When we have this discussion on this floor, or any discussion about the gospel, we're always talking about Yahshua the Messiah. We're just using different topics to promote that which we are discussing. But it's always been about him. Okay. With that being said, we are going to need to get the scripture lesson. But while you're at it, get Genesis 12 and 1. And then also 15 and 12. And then we're going to start backwards and then go forward and then go backwards again. So the first scripture I want is Hebrews 11 and 1. But only because I just want to get to the part about Abraham, then we'll move on from there. So Hebrews, if you can, if you will.
Hebrews 11 and 1.
Please.
Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen.
Read.
For by it the elders obtain a good report.
Now, we need to understand what faith is so that we can even talk about this gospel. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. So that means we're going to have some hope. But at the same time, we're going to receive some evidence to establish our faith. Now, Don, you got a new car out there. I bet all the money in your pocket, you have faith that car is going to start when you get out there today. Why is that? Is it because it's brand new?
Yes.
Is it because when you started this morning, it started without no problems? Right? And when you drove here, you drove without no problems, right?
So you got a few witnesses or some evidence that establish your faith that when you walk out this place, you ain't going to have no issues with that car. Right. Now, if I was to ask you, hey, you got faith that you're going to have $1 million in your bank account if you want to go check it right now? You'd be like, heck no. And don't look at my account because it ain't none of your business, right? So Yahweh don't do anything without establishing your faith. He did it with Moses down here. Mm-hmm. Not only did he get him out of here and separate him from his kindred, but when he talked to him, he called him by name. He told him who he was the Elohim of. And then he said, hey, let me show you some signs and wonders to show you that not only am I powerful, but I'll be with you. And he established his faith. He told him to cast his rod on the ground. Boom. Turned to a serpent. And he said, pick it up by the tail, which you don't do when you deal with no dang snake. Because things just turn around and just bite you, right? Especially if it's a black mamba. Ooh, you don't want that. Right? And he turned right back into a rod. He said, put your hand in your bosom. Pull it out, turn into leprous. Incurable disease. Put your hand back in your bosom. Turn back into his flesh. Mm-hmm. The point being, Yahweh don't do anything without establishing your faith. I have a really good friend. I've known her since I was 14 years old. She's had diabetes all her life. She's been dying, literally a slow, painful death, since she was 16 years old. Mm. Yesterday, she just got a kidney and a pancreas. She was on dialysis to the point where she'd been on dialysis for 8-9 years. She just received her kidney. She's recovering right now. This woman's been beat down all around, and all of a sudden, she was, her faith in whatever, if she had any doubt, she just got relief right now because of what she received. Got a phone call, said, hey, you want this kidney? Show up tomorrow. Literally, that's how that went.
Yeah. Wow.
I ain't joking. And typically, you got to wait for someone, this person to die, and that person to die, and they hold this. No. This person happened to have a match for her pancreas and her kidney.
Wow.
And she got it out. Boom. Talk about Yahweh establishing somebody's faith. She ain't going to never curse Yahweh. I'm just saying. That's how Yahweh deals with them. Okay? Read.
Oh. Sorry.
3. Through faith, we understand that the ages were framed by the word of Elohim.
Read.
So that things which were not in evidence are now seen coming to pass.
Read.
By faith, Abel offered unto Yahweh a more excellent sacrifice than Cain.
Now, when he offered that sacrifice, it wasn't that it was better. It was just a more excellent one. Meaning, Cain's offering wasn't bad. It was just out of season. It wasn't time for the first fruits. Read.
By which he obtained witness that he was righteous, Yahweh testifying of his gifts, and by it he being dead yet speaketh. By faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found because Yahweh had translated him.
Read.
For before his translation he had this testimony that he pleased Yahweh.
Read.
But without faith, it is impossible to please him.
You can't please Yahweh without faith. And please, don't be doing this blind stuff. Because blind people follow the wrong folks. We see it all the time. We got a TV evangelist talking about, oh, look at all these riches I got. Praise God. Pay me. And people blindly follow them. Not asking for any evidence, ain't getting no scriptures, proving nothing.
That's right.
Just make you feel all good. ain't no lie. But at the same time, those same people that are giving all this stuff away, they ain't prospering. But he is.
Yeah, right.
Read.
For he that cometh to Yahweh must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Read on.
By faith Noah, being warned by Yahweh of things not seen as yet.
Now keep in mind, talked about the ages being framed, And so he's establishing how these ages are being framed through these figures. Mm-hmm. So first you talked about Abel. During Adam's time. Now he's at Noah, right? Read.
Moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith.
Read.
By faith, Abraham.
Oh. When so he went from Abel to Noah. Now we have Abraham. Mm-hmm. He sounds like he's following the age of dispensations, right?
Right.
Look like he's following a pattern, right?
Right.
Death, burial. Now we're about to be resurrected, right? Read on.
By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should afterwards receive for an inheritance, obeyed, and he went out, not knowing whither he went. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise.
Read on.
For he looked for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is Yahweh.
Now, mind you, and this is to answer that question. By faith, Yahweh came to Abraham with a promise. That promise was a blessing for not just him, but all men. Because through his seed, Abraham's seed, would all of the earth be blessed. And typically, the father gives off the seed, not the mother, right? So when he says in Romans that he's the father of Esau, it is a metaphor, meaning that his seed is going to bless the earth. Because Abraham gave birth to Isaac, Isaac gave birth to Jacob, and through that lineage do we have the 12 tribes of Israel. From those lineages, we have the tribe of Judah, and Yahshua Messiah, which came from the tribe of Judah, was the one that saved Esau. Does that make sense? Close enough? Okay. Read on.
For he looked for a city. 11. Through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age.
Read.
Because she judged him faithful who had promised.
Read.
Therefore sprang there even of one, and him as good as dead. So many as the stars of the sky in multitude, and as the sand which is by the seashore innumerable. These all died in faith, not having received the promise, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth.
Now give me Genesis 12 and 1.
Genesis 12 and 1.
Read.
Now Yahweh had said unto Abram. Abram, yeah.
Now we're going to confirm that which we read in Hebrews. So now we're going to read it for ourselves. Read.
Get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee.
Now Abraham came from Ur of the Chaldees. They were nothing but, they were idol worshipers. They made graven idols. That's what he. That's what they did at that time. That's what his family did. And Yahweh said he's a jealous cell, right? No graven idol shall you take before me. So he's going to sanctify him or separate him from his family because he's going to start something anew. He has been chosen to be something different. Read on.
And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing.
Read.
And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee.
Read on.
And in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed.
So here, through Abraham's seed, all the families of the earth. You got a family? You got a family? Sean, you got a family? Don, you got a family? Everybody in here got a family, right? We all blessed because of this event right now. Read.
So Abram departed as Yahweh had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran.
Read.
And Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their substance that they had gathered, and the souls that they had gotten in Haran. And they went forth to go into the land of Canaan. Mm-hmm. And in the land of Canaan they came. And Abram passed through the land, which the place of the Shittim, until the plain of Moreh. Okay. And the Canaanites was then in the land.
So now, 15 and 12.
And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram.
Read.
And lo, a horror of great darkness fell upon him.
Read.
And he said unto Abram, know of an assurity that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs.
So now he says, hey, I'm going to bless you. And now he's coming to him again saying, hey, man, know of a surety, your seed is going to be in a land that they know not of. Read.
And shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years.
So he said, initially, I'm going to give you a blessing. I'm going to give you a promise that I'm going to take you and your seed to a land flowing with milk and honey. It's going to be the promised land. But before you receive your blessing, you're going to go through some things. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine? I'm going to give you $1 million, but you're going to go through some stuff before you get it. Man, that's rough. Like, who wants to be that guy? Like, you remember those Klondike bar commercials? Like, what would you do for a Klondike bar, right? Yeah. Like, would you go on this coffin full of snakes and scorpions? No. Would you do it for a Klondike bar? Sure, why not? That's what they would do. Stupid stuff. I remember these. If you ever listened to the house party way back in the 90s, they had John London and Shirley Strawberry. Anybody remember that? Okay.
Yeah.
And they would do a spoof on that, but they was a little vulgar with it. It was hilarious, but they would do it for a Klondike bar. The point is, y'all are saying, I'm going to give you something, but you're going to have to, I'm going to establish my faith with you and give you a promise, but I got to try you first. Mm-hmm. He wants to see, can you endure?
Yeah, that's right.
Because he says, if you diligently seek me, I'll give you all that you ask for. So he wants to know, are they going to be diligent in following what he's saying? Are they going to follow my commandments? Are they going to listen to what I'm telling them? We do it all the time, right? We get in these relationships with people and we try to identify red flags. We do it with our friends. We do it with our lovers. We want to find out, are they going to lead us down the right path? Are they good for us? Are they going to trick me, take me for all I got? Right. Hey, you ever seen the original Coming to America? He didn't tell her that I'm a prince. He could have walked up to us, hey, I'm Simi of Zamunda. I live in large. Come on, let's do this. But he wanted to know if she's the right person for him.
Right.
He had something waiting for him. Mm-hmm. He had a whole kingdom. He could have just ran off with it. Mm-hmm. But he said, no, I want someone who I can relate to emotionally. I want a connection. Right. I don't just want to be attached to this person because I'm attached to him. I want to be connected with them. Right. Mm-hmm. Yahweh's looking for you to connect.
That's right.
He connects with you on a spiritual level. He doesn't talk to your flesh. He connects and attaches. He talks to your spirit. Mm-hmm. He communes with you spiritually. He wants to know the soul of the man.
Right.
Not what you can do for him. He don't need you.
That's right. True that.
Creator heaven and earth needs you. Really? So he's trying to connect. Trying to figure out who you are. He's going to put you through some things. They were evilly entreated for 430 years.
Yeah.
Can you endure? We don't even want to deal with a person for 4 days. We want ours now. Can I go out with you? Nope. Never mind. Move on. Can I go out with you? No. Nope. Right? We don't want to try to woo you, get to know you, spend some time, be vulnerable. We don't want to do all that. We want instant gratification. I was talking about this the other day. In the 90s, If he heard that and it's dialing up and we just knew we about to get on the internet. We just got to wait a couple minutes.
Yeah.
Now we press the button and it's buffering for a few seconds. We're like, oh gosh, come on, my internet's not working. Do we not do that
every day?
If we gotta wait 5 seconds for the screen to change from one to the next, we upset. We want to kill somebody. Cause we our faith is like, oh, there's something wrong with the towers.
Right.
You know, I want to change Verizon. I don't want to deal with them no more. Mm-hmm. I'm going to T-Mobile.
Yeah.
430 years. We can't even last 4 seconds.
I know, that's right.
That's crazy.
Yep.
But these are the times. Yeah. Now y'all always saying, hey, I got a promise for you. But you're gonna have to go serve these people for a minute. You're gonna be in some mess. Because I want to know, are you willing to go the distance for me like I'm willing to go for you?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Don't we do that today? Don't we have those same dilemmas?
Right.
We have relationships. I got a kid right now who don't want to go the distance for me. I've been carrying this kid all his life. This kid forgot all about me.
Yeah.
he's out on his own, doing his own thing. Give me, can I have, pay my cell phone bill, let me drive your car. Borrow my car for 2 weeks, didn't even bring it back with no gas in it. Like, who are you? Really? And then when I presented, oh, I'll come back. Oh, I just noticed I got to clean it. Now you realize you got to clean it? Really? I gave it to you with a full tank of gas. It was clean when you got it. Right? That's how we treat each other. But the point I'm making is, Yahweh has always been long-suffering. We talked about this last week about love, right? One of his 9 major attributes is love. That is an enduring thing. It's unconditional. He establishes our faith and he provides you evidence. He gives you something to hold on to before you even have to jump on his bandwagon. And the crazy part is, he doesn't even have to do that.
That's right.
He does that for the love of you, so you feel comfortable. He could just instantly make it happen without you. But he's following a pattern. He doesn't veer from it. My friend suffered for 20 years before she got a kidney and a pancreas. Lost her eyesight, had some strokes, had a heart attack, had a DKA, which is a diabetic coma. She's been all through that.
Wow.
And guess what? She's still here, still ticking. Eats something, throws it up. Went from being rotund, couldn't even put on weight. When she was big, she complained about being skinny. When she's skinny, she's like, oh, nobody likes me anymore. I don't have any curves. Really, make up your mind. That's what we do.
Yeah. That's right.
She was mad because she couldn't gain the weight. Put on some weight. Oh, my clothes don't fit anymore. You wanted to gain weight. What now? What do you want to do? You know what she's really in for? She's about to be normal again. She gonna have to know what it's like to go up and down every dang week, right? We go through it all the time. Now she gonna really have to deal with body image issues. She can have to worry about that in eons. Now she's gonna have to deal with it. But we're talking about faith. And we're only talking about faith to get to a point about the difference between the circumcision and the uncircumcised, or carnality versus spirituality.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're really talking about. See, Yahshua is spirit. Everything about him is spiritual. And everything that you see and don't see is spirit materialized in some shape, form, or fashion. Yahshua is conscious of it. He is aware of it. And when he deals with a man or just anything he does, it's always in the spirit. Now us, because we have these human conditions, we toggle between back and forth, right? We have this internal struggle. Do we love unconditionally? Or we, should we make sure that they do X, Y, and Z before we give them our love? Mm. Right? Do we do good things because it's the right thing to do? Or do we do what's best for us? Is there something wrong with self-love? Or is that just being selfish? Do you see what I'm saying? We want our young girls to be confident and love themselves. But then you got men that, we don't like that. I feel threatened. Right. Mm-hmm. Are we supposed to be alphas or betas? What's the right thing to do? This is our conflict that we deal with every day. It's called the human condition. Mm-hmm. But it is all about carnality versus spirituality. That's all that is. What's important? How someone feels about us? Is that important? Yeah. Why? Why is that important? Do you think Yahweh cares whether you love him or not?
Really?
Because Yahweh so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He loved the world, his creation, that he gave of himself. He didn't care if you earned it or not. This happened regardless if you earned it or not. Just name one. If you earned your salvation, please raise your hand and then show me how you did it so I can emulate it to guarantee me salvation. Go ahead. Anybody in the room? That's the point I'm making. So why do we care so much what other people think about how we feel? But guess what? We can leave this room today after hearing all this, and it sounds really good. And now you got to go actually execute it. And we always remember our humanity when we walk out this door. Because guess what? That doesn't leave us. It's hard. He says, my burden is light. You know why it's light? Because he ain't worried about what nobody else is thinking. He don't care. He is all in the spirit. This is all he cares about. We care about this. Yahweh only cares about the spirit of a man. He's not worried about pronouns. He's not worried about skin color. He's not worried about your gender. He's not even worried about your appearance. We care about that. Mm-hmm. So he decided, I'm going to promise you this, Abraham. But, by the way, I'm giving it to you when you're in your late in years. No kids will you have until then. I want to see, are you going to stay the course? And oh, by the way, that woman, that fine woman you got, yeah, she's going to be barren for a while. Good luck. So he says, Sarah, because she wants to make sure she pleases her husband, says, hey, take my handmaiden, take Hagar. Abraham wasn't like, don't threaten me with a good time, right? He went on and did that and had him a son. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't the right seed. Mm-hmm. That wasn't the promised seed. Yeah. Y'all was like, hey, what? I got to do when you get ready? He wasted, he's up in years to give him the child that he's supposed to have. So he gives him a son, right? Then he says, kill that son. I just got him. I did all this work. I've been patient. Yeah. But because Yahweh established his faith, he said, hey, chill out. I gave him to you. Just know I got you. And being the father of faith, he did exactly that. He offered his son up. He killed him in the spirit. Because remember, you're always not dealing with your flesh. He's not doing that. He's dealing with your spirit. So when he killed him in his mind, he had already said, you know what? It is what it is. Mm-hmm. I gotta go. Yahweh's gonna do, he's gonna redeem me somehow. When he did that, he's like, that's all I needed. I wanted to make sure you're gonna do exactly what I need you to do. All right, we can keep moving. We keep this train moving. He didn't need the physical sacrifice. He wanted to know, are you going to follow me? Mm-hmm. And he did just that. Mm-hmm. Mentally, he killed him in his mind, Abraham. And he had already considered him dead and buried. All he had to do was execute it. And when he when that angel stopped his hand, that was his resurrection. He followed a pattern. Mm-hmm. Yahweh doesn't mess around with anything else. He just stays to the pattern, stays true. It's like a perpetual algorithm that just keeps going. I'm not saying that's what it is in reality, but it's basically like that when you think about what an algorithm is. It just keeps going, and it has its own pattern, and it just repeats itself, and it has its rules and its things that makes it happen. And guess what? It's universal. There's only one language that everyone on the earth speaks fluently. Math. Math is the only thing that we can, no matter where we go, what part of the world, what part of the universe, math is universal. It is a language all its own. And if you want to do math in India? Indians know how to do some math. They'll run some numbers for you. The same way we run numbers here is the same way they run numbers there. Now, I will say this. Americans like to trick. We like to mess things up, I swear. Have you seen our tax system compared to everybody else's? It's ridiculous. Mm. We're paying through the nose. It don't make no sense. But, hey, I don't want to digress. But the point is, math is universal. This pattern is universal. It is perpetual. Mm-hmm. It is infallible. It has yet to be wrong. And it is going throughout all eternity, throughout the universe, without fail. And everything it follows that pattern. Universal spirit law has not failed yet.
That's right.
That's like saying Yahweh makes mistakes. Mm-hmm. And he just hasn't done that.
Nope.
Because even when he appears to have made a mistake, he is all the pattern makes it whole. It has yet to fail. Mm-hmm. So we're done with that. Get us Romans, 4th chapter.
Romans 4 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
What shall we say then? Mm. That Abraham, our fathers, as pertaining to the flesh, has found? For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before Yahweh.
Read.
For what saith the scripture?
Mm-hmm.
Abraham believed Yahweh, mm-hmm. and it was counted unto him for righteousness.
Read.
Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt.
Read. Wait. Read that again.
Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. But
now, salvation was given to us by grace. And grace is nothing more than unmerited favor. Meaning there is nothing you can do to just receive the grace of Yahweh. Absolutely nothing can you do to earn the salvation of Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
But yet we receive it regardless. I remember sitting in that hotel just around the corner at the Ramada. At the time, it wasn't called the Ramada. I don't know what it was called. There was this controversy throughout the class. I think, Bud, maybe you will remember it. Who is saved and how do you know you're saved? And then it was, who has the Holy Spirit and how do you know? Like, that's what everybody was talking about. That was our controversy throughout the class. None of this birth son stuff. None of this saved in the name of Dr. Henry Clifford. We were talking about actual principles. Like, who had the Holy Spirit? That was the controversy. Man, I wish those days were here. That I can live with. That could be rectified through the scriptures. Mm-hmm. And listen, it was so confusing and so up in arms that classes would literally be just fighting tooth and nail about who got the Holy Spirit and who don't. It was ridiculous. Who cares? I get that. But who cares? What people didn't want to focus on is he has the Holy Spirit. He is the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. It wasn't about him. Yeah. Everyone was looking at, oh, she's got the Holy Spirit because she can talk. She knows how to do it. Oh, no. Joe Williams got the Holy Spirit because, you know, he get on that floor and run them charts. That's what the controversy was. Thank you. Everybody was looking outside of themselves, worried about everyone else. Your salvation is yours alone. I can't be worried about Samuel. You going to be saved? Who? I can't really be worried about him because he shouldn't be worried about me. This is about our journey. Carnality makes us wonder about, ooh, what is Glennett out there doing? Mm-hmm. Right? Isn't that what y'all do every Thursday before you get to the pool? Gossiping about who shot John? What did Edna do? Right? Looking like a hussy? Right. Got her toes all out, right? What y'all talk about? Yeah. Edna living her best life. And you up there worried about what Edna doing. Carnality. The spirit of the man, the carnality of a man. What are we talking about? Read.
Five. But to him that worketh not, mm-hmm. but believeth on him mm-hmm. that justifieth the unrighteous, his faith is counted for righteousness.
Read.
Even as David also described the blessedness of the man, mm-hmm. unto whom Yahweh imputed righteousness apart so from works.
So you got those that want to be out there working and spending their money, trying to help people and trying to buy their way into heaven. He's saying he's just reckoning it unto debt. Okay. But the guy who's just sitting there, he says, you know what? I'm not getting out there. I just can't do it. But I know my Redeemer liveth. Mm-hmm. That's the one that we always dealing with because he believes. He has faith. He believes the report. We just read about faith in Hebrews that if you believe, then I will reward you because you diligently seek me. Mm-hmm. I just need you to believe. That's it. That's all the work you need to do. That don't require a whole lot of muscle memory.
No, it doesn't.
Hardly any effort. It is opening up yourself and allowing the Spirit to do the work for you. You don't even have to move a muscle. Just believe. You believe your car gonna work. Believe in him. You believe in taxes. Believe in him. That's all he's saying. Read.
Saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven mm-hmm. and whose sins are covered. Mm-hmm. Blessed is the man to whom Yahweh will not impute sin. Mm-hmm. Cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision only?
Now read that again. Blessed is the man that will not impute sin.
Right.
Why? Why is that? Because if you believe that he took sin out of the way or this law out of the way, then there is no sin in this age. Mm-hmm. because the law makes sin more exceedingly sinful. Mm-hmm. But this law was taken out of the way because he performed it.
Right.
There is no, where is that at? What's the scripture? Dag nabbit. Is it in Thessalonians? Sin is not imputed where there is no law. Yeah, 5:13.
Romans 5:13.
Read.
For until the law, sin was in the world. But sin is not imputed where there is no law.
Read.
Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses.
Now, Adam to Moses doesn't mean literally it, just Adam himself. And then when Moses came, that's when death. No, the time of Moses ended with the Messiah. Remember, men open and close an age. We read it in Hebrews how the world, the ages or the world was framed, right? Well, it was framed through men. He started off with Adam. We're talking about Abel, right? Mm-hmm. Through that man, Adam, was that first, was the antediluvian age in play. Noah closed it out and started the new one. Here comes Abraham. So this ended when Abraham came on the scene. Then Abraham went to Moses. And then Moses to Yahshua Messiah. That's how the ages were framed, through a man. So we're reading right now that there was no, that death reigned from Adam to Moses. Mm-hmm. Now the death that we're talking about was the death in the in his consciousness, in man's mind.
Right.
You ever try talking to someone who just can't see it?
Yeah.
Mentally?
Yeah.
I'm dealing with someone right now who mentally just can't see it. They have all these gifts, but they just can't see it.
Right.
Because they are blinded in their consciousness. They still think that's about, there's a you and them, you and Yahweh. They really think it's about them, how right. they feel. Validate me, reassure me, make me feel whole. That's crazy. Death came by man. This man took death out of the way. He conquered it by dying himself and then resurrecting from that death. That is how he did it. And he's like the Babe Ruth of dying. He called his shot. He said, yeah, I'm going to die and I'm going to resurrect over here. And dag nabbit, did he not do it? That's called Babe Ruth to me, the Babe Ruth effect. Literally called his shot and hit it. Read.
Even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come.
Read.
But not as the offense, so also is the free gift.
Did he say it was a gift that cost some money?
Free.
Are you sure? Because you know, there's nothing in this life that's for free.
Right. Yeah.
Right. I mean, this is typically how it goes. Everything has a price, does it not? Yeah. I mean, let's be frank. Like if I give you $20, I expect a little get back. Isn't that how we do? But y'all are saying, listen, this is a free gift. Mm-hmm. You can't earn this. It's nothing you could do to make this up. Like, how do you make up salvation? Hey, really? Mm. Can you imagine? That's like selling air. If I could create oxygen that everyone breathes, and I could just dictate how much air you get to breathe and don't breathe, I'd be a zillionaire. I'd be the first zillionaire. I mean, sign me up. Because I got some people, I'm gonna siphon some air out of them. I'm just going to be honest with you. They don't deserve this thing. Read.
For if through the offense of one, many be dead, and the gift by grace, much more the grace of Yahweh and the gift by grace,
read,
which is by one man, Yahshua the Messiah, has abounded unto many.
Now, before we read that, that's what we were talking about, right? How Yahshua gave us this gift of salvation through faith, if we so believed. And earlier, Paul was talking about how you can't, the sin is not imputed. And then he further went on to explain that in the next chapter. So we hear worried about sin. Like, there's a whole group of people, billions of people, who think that they're committing sin by swearing, saying bad words. Like, now we're just creating sins. Oh, she got drunk last night. She's a hussy. That's a sin now. I slapped my kid last night. That's a sin now. Like, what are we talking about? Like, people don't even know what a sin is. This law that was given to them, none of that was a sin. The Messiah was drunk throughout the entire scriptures. But he didn't sin. But yet, we're going to hold someone accountable to smoking and drinking the whole nine yards. Like, that matters. Because it didn't, it wasn't about that. See, all that that people do in excess, that speaks to what they are running from. Their addiction is not the problem. What causes them to use that substance for their addiction is the problem.
Right.
Some people run because they don't want to feel the pain that they've been ignoring all their life. We spend our entire adulthood trying to get over our childhood. I'm not joking. That's reality. I see a therapist every Saturday. And even this man was telling me about, he didn't say who it was or give me, he was talking about how he has an 80-year-old female patient. How she, at 80 years old, thought, I wouldn't have these anxieties anymore. And she's married. She thought she would be past this at 80 years old. She's been married for over 50 years. She's saying, even at 80, I have the same anxieties I did when I was 35. So that tells you something. The issue doesn't just go away over time. The issues don't go away because you mask the pain with drugs or alcohol or whatever your addiction is or whatever your affliction is. Your carnality is perpetual as long as you let it take over you. That's why when you're in AA, they say, hey, we need to give it to somebody higher, a higher power more than us, because we can't handle it. We, as our carnal flesh-minded people, we carnally can't handle it. So we give it to this spiritual creature, whoever that is. And they're ambiguous on purpose because we don't want to hurt anybody's feelings, right? They're saying, give it to your higher power. Do we not say, hey, man, just believe that Yahweh's got you and you're blessed and it goes away? It's no different. Our carnality is only going to persist as long as we let something else cloud our judgment. When we recognize that Yahshua Messiah is the one that's reigning on our throne, and that we don't have to worry about who shot John, or do I look okay in this dress, or hey, do I make enough money? Hey, are my kids, do they appreciate me as a parent? Does Yahweh care? Why do we care? So when people tell me, oh, I'm 3 years sober. No, this is what I do. I'm like, hey, come on, celebrate that. That's huge. That takes some work. That means they were steeped in carnality. Mm-hmm. They were here. and they embrace spirituality. That's what they're saying. I celebrate that. That's huge. Do you know what it takes to abstain from your flesh? Yeah. It feels good. It feels good to hide from your problems. I ain't gonna lie to you. It's easy to be like, oh, I just gotta drink this. I don't have to deal with that. Sign me up. Double whiskey, Jack and Coke. You know, that's my drink of choice. If I was gonna drink, yeah. But my point is, we always want to mask our pain to avoid dealing with the fact that, hey, our dad slapped the hell out of us one day when we were three. And we don't understand why. And we still waiting for them to say sorry. And they're dead. Good luck.
Really?
Yeah. Or our mom didn't give us that hug when when Johnny, broke our hearts. Well, your mom knew something that you didn't know. Johnny wasn't important. You feel Johnny's important because of your flesh. She realized there's a guy named Jack around the corner. He was way better than Johnny. I'm just waiting for you to see it. Do you get my point?
Right. Yeah.
But yeah. We spent our whole adulthood trying to get over our childhood. And for what? And here's the punchline. Here's the crazy thing. Because had our parents recognized that there are certain things that they could do to help us process those things, so that we don't focus on it as a kid, to a teenager, to a young adult, to an adult, to where we're elders trying to figure out why do we feel this way. We let decades go before we address it. Y'all always saying, hey, if you believe in me from the beginning, you don't have to worry about all that. Mm-hmm. All we got to do is just let it go as a child. That's why you see some really adjusted kids growing up, because they've been allowed to express themselves about it. But then they were taught, hey, you can't focus so much on that, because not everybody needs to deal with hear your nonsense. Sometimes you go in your room and cry it out and come out when you're done. You got it out your system, right? You feel better? Come on, let's hug it out. All right, now get off there and go have some fun. That's what we do. That's what we're supposed to do. Right. Instead, we got some parent by, hey, stop crying. I'll be the first one to say it. I wasn't allowed to cry. I wasn't allowed to cry. I didn't have toys. I wasn't given a chance to really tell you how I felt. Is it his fault? No. Do I hate him? No, not at all. He can only give me what he was given.
That's right.
It's not his fault. I don't blame my father for my problems. And guess what? He did not blame his parents for his. Mm-hmm. Believe me, he had a ton of them. And his parents had problems. And there's a cycle of problems. Because we don't want to deal with nothing. So we turn to our vices. Mm-hmm. Some like the shop. Some like to drink. Some like a little heroin. Some like meth. Some like to eat. We all have our vices. There's not one person in this room that don't have a vice. Okay? And it don't make you less than a person. Don't make you bad. It just means you have the same problem that everyone else got. You are blind to the fact that Yahweh matters more than you, and it ain't about you. Our carnality clouds our judgment. It makes us think that the problem is bigger than it really is. So, Abraham circumcised his entire family. And that circumcision was a type and a shadow to the true circumcision of your mind, the carnality, your flesh. We're cut off the foreskin, the head, right? So that we can expose ourselves and have access to the spirit. Mm-hmm. So there's got to be a spiritual cutting away of our flesh. See, this was done physically so with the male babies. But because we all constitute the bride or the sons of Yahweh, we all have to have that cutting away of our flesh. That's what Paul is talking about. People are still following this stinking law as if it's still in existence. Not realizing it was just a metaphor. It was just something for us to look at to get our minds focused on getting right. It was a burden. Hey, this thing was heavy. Can you imagine? You got to wake up on the right side of the bed. Oh, got on the wrong side of the bed. Like, you literally had to get up on a certain side of the bed according to this law. How stupid is that? It was so arbitrary that these people to this day still think they're supposed to do it. It's like they didn't get it. They weren't looking. They were so carnal. Do you know they are so carnal that these people were down here in bondage and didn't know they were in bondage? Aren't we like that today? We have women who stay in marriages getting their butts kicked all because the guy says, oh, I love you, baby. You ever listen to Dave? Anybody like Dave Chappelle? You see, especially he talked about Iceberg Slim. Okay, so I'll give you a story about Iceberg. Iceberg Slim was wondering, he had this problem with one of his ladies. And he asked an old pimp, hey, man, I'm having trouble with this woman. She's just getting out of hand. How do I fix it? He goes, you take a coat hanger and beat her over the head with it. And before you finish, go draw her a bath and bathe her and clean her up and then put her in the bed. She'll love you because you fixed her. And forget the fact that you broke her in the first place. That's how we think.
We do.
That's how we think. Dave Chappelle used the allegory of the story, the life story of Iceberg Slim, in reference to why he lost his show and what happened to him. Because it's a hustle. It's a game. Satan is no joke. This will mess with you if you allow it. And we do that all the time. We allow people to do this. I know too many people that will be abused mentally, physically, and will stay in that situation because they think they love them. I just love this person so much. Not realizing that that's not love. It's called you're attached to this person and you got some issues you need to deal with. Love does not beat the hell out of you. I'm just saying. Love creates something special. It does not beat you down. Now, you may have to earn love, and that in itself may beat you down. But you do not get love to kill you. Love doesn't do that. Love is hard because people are stupid. We just can't help ourselves. But Yahweh is not going to make love one of his 9 major attributes so that you can go through hell like that. No, it's not what he does. You get what I'm saying? But let's continue reading because I want to get to a certain point.
16. Mm-hmm. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift.
Are we still in? Go back to the fourth chapter.
Four.
Yeah.
Let's start at 5. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the unrighteous, his faith is counted for righteousness. Mm-hmm. Even as David also.
You already read that.
Yeah.
Keep going. Might as well just keep going. We got time. Because I know where I'm going to end, so just go ahead. You got time.
Oh, we were at 9. I'll keep going.
Go ahead.
Okay. Even as David also described the blessedness of the man, mm-hmm. unto whom Yahweh imputed righteousness apart from works.
Read.
Saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven mm-hmm. and whose sins are covered.
Mm-hmm.
Blessed is the man to whom Yahweh will not impute sin.
Mm-hmm.
Cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision only
mm-hmm.
or upon the uncircumcision also?
So he's saying, listen, you're blessed whether you were circumcised or uncircumcised. Whether you had some iniquities that you were subjected to, or you were living under, or you didn't. Saying the blessing doesn't matter, just like cancer. It don't matter if you got good cells or bad cells, killing everything. It's indiscriminate. And so is this blessing. The blessing is coming regardless of you deserving it or not. And when you think about it, nobody really deserves this. Some people may find this to be a little bit controversial. But I'm going to be honest with you. When people work for a company, they believe when they walk through the door, I'm here to help you make money. Pay me, pay me, pay me. As if you earned it. Not realizing that that person that started that company took some huge risk and pays a lot of money to ensure that not only are you employed, you got tools, you got healthcare, you got all these things, all these regulations that they got to provide that are really outside of what you do. And you haven't really earned anything. That wage that you're getting paid, that's great, but what else are you doing?
Right.
Because when you leave, your job is done. That owner, that person that owns that thing, that's 24 hours. They don't get no breaks. They don't get to turn it off. They don't get to go to Barbados and have a vacation. They still working. They still got to worry about, hey, did I cross off this? Did I get this done? While you at home nestling in your bed, they're like worrying about, oh my gosh, PAX is coming. You know, and like that's what they think about. Who's paying for that?
Yep, that's right.
Do you realize that if they insure themselves, their premium goes up that much more because anyone could just decide, you know what? I'm going to sue my company and be done with this and get hurt. Employees do it all the time. Why would an employer do it? The first thing they ask, Mr. Williams, are you going to insure yourself? I'm like, nope. Well, that makes life simple, right? That's how this is with our salvation. That's how it is with Yahweh. Yahweh ain't worried about whether you deserve it or not. Because there's not enough things in the world that you could do to earn salvation. That's eternal true. Life. Really? Forever?
That's true.
I get to have this forever and all I got to do is believe? Seems like a small price to pay when you think about it.
Mm-hmm.
And we still mess that up. Don't we? Read.
10. How was it then reckoned
mm-hmm.
when he was in circumcision mm-hmm. or in uncircumcision? Not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision.
Read.
And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of righteousness mm-hmm. of the faith which he had yet been uncircumcised.
So when the Messiah took off the flesh and it said the veil in the tabernacle writ in twain, that was a circumcision in principle that we are supposed to experience within ourselves. Mm-hmm. So that when we truly believe and have embraced Yahweh's ever presence, that hey, he did exactly what he said. Not only did he create a creation, but he came in himself and walked the ages and dispensations as Bud Wunsch, as Samuel Salas, as Eunice Reiser, that's what he
right.
did.
Mm-hmm.
He's doing this work. You just gotta believe.
Mm-hmm.
And we still don't wanna do that because we can't separate the fact that, well, you know, I cheated on my wife once, you know. Or, you know, I was supposed to be on this diet and I was sneaking out when everybody was looking and eating things I had no business. Because Yahweh doesn't do that.
Mm-hmm.
Then if Yahweh don't do it, then who does?
Really? That's right.
No. I'm going there. I can't help it. It's just, it's the rebel in me. He creates a creation, right? Yahweh Elohim is that creation. Everything that is going to come from this creature, from this being, is going to be manifested in the flesh, right? But we're going to tell that LGBTQ couple, you're an abomination. Mm. Really? We're going to say that gays can't get married because it goes against the Bible. Really?
Yeah, really.
Really? That's what we're doing? we're going to say that men being with men is an issue. But yet, everything he said he created is good and very good. Just so y'all know, there's homosexuality in nature. There isn't anywhere in our society where there isn't homosexuality or hasn't been since the start of time. I'm sorry to tell you that. Just because it's not part of what you believe and what you feel is comfortable,
right,
doesn't make it wrong.
Right.
I spent an entire lecture talking about how Yahweh doesn't care about you. Mm-hmm. Why does he care about your sexuality? He created it. Why would he care if all he wants you to believe is that he did that? What does it matter? That's your flesh getting in the way of your spirituality. Because guess what? I could cut everyone open and just expose their spirituality. We wouldn't know if you were gay or straight.
That's right. That's right.
We would just know that you have a spiritual body, mm-hmm, floating in the wind. But we care about someone's sexuality. What someone does in their private life. And yes, in this law, it talks about fornication, which we all do freely. But it also talks about homosexuality. They both weren't written in the law.
Right.
But yeah, we accept one because it's something that everyone can do normally. But because it's something that goes against the grain a little bit, now we got a problem with it? Even though everyone's been doing it since the start of time. Really? That's what we're talking about? It's our carnality. Because guess what? It was taken out of the way.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. We'll keep the fornication, but we're going to say something about homosexuality. That's what we're talking about? That's what we're doing? Do I care that people are going to scrutinize me? No, I don't care. Because guess what? I just want you to prove me wrong. Prove me wrong. Because last time I checked, spirit is in everything and everywhere we are. And he said, I create good and I create evil. I, Yahweh, create all these things.
That's right.
For my good pleasure.
That's right.
Yeah. That's true.
So guess what? He created homosexuality as well. Sorry to say, he created transsexuals too.
Yep.
He also created schizophrenics.
That's right.
And last time I checked, drug addicts, alcoholics,
yep,
cheaters, winners. He created all of them. Everyone has their place in heaven. If you so believe. It ain't about you and what you think and feel. Last time I checked, wait a second. Shucks. Oh, yeah, it's on here. Your theories, concepts, and opinion. Yeah, it's on that side. The side that don't matter. That's why I don't get tripped up when people say, God hates gay people. Prove it. Yeah. That's all I ask. Just prove it. Well, in Exodus and... Okay. I get it. You don't know what you're talking about. Because all I got to do is read what we just read in Romans about how sin is not imputed. Because, yes, true. According to this law, homosexuality is a sin. I'm not going to debate that with you.
Right.
That is a fact. However, it was taken out of the way. Now, there's this thing called spiritual homosexuality. But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about something physical. We're not talking about something spiritual. We're talking about physical actions that are occurring on this earth that has nothing to do with the... I know someone that is in this gospel, has gotten on this floor and has preached the gospel in its simplicity, even though sometimes they believe some crazy stuff. But they ran these charts, talked about Yahweh, preached the gospel, and they're as gay as they come. So you're saying this same gay person that can preach the gospel, he's going to hell because he... Really? But yet, we can allow preachers to impregnate this one, but preach the gospel in the same church, and yet they're going to heaven because, you know what, at least they did it to a woman. Really? Really? That's what we're doing? I'm just saying. And I hate to do it in this form, but I'm sorry. I came by that. I'm not even about gay rights and all stuff. I'm black. I ain't here. There's a whole lot of rights we didn't get. I don't care about any of that. Because guess what? Last time I checked, Yahshua Messiah said, I'm good and very good. And I'm good to go. That's all I care about. I don't care about all this other stuff. I may lose some people on that. I'm good with that. Just prove me wrong. Mm-hmm. Because yes, it is written in the law. But so is fornication. And last time I checked, there's a lot of fornicators out there. I'm just saying. I'm being honest with you guys. I'm not exempt. So, if it's written in the law and he took it out of the way, then it ain't imputed. And it's not a sin. Now, we can debate that if you want to. And I'm sorry to digress. But I don't get very many opportunities to talk about this. And listen, you don't have to accept it or believe it because I said it. Yahweh will reveal it to you if he wants to or not. That's just the way I see it according to the scripture, according to the pattern. Because guess what? Satan was here too.
Right.
And listen, he says Satan's is his asset, not his liability. And some would say, well, that is of Satan. Okay. But last time I checked, I'm just saying, last time I checked, the spirit of man is what matters. I cuss like a sailor outside of class. But I'd be the first person to talk about Yahweh and his purpose in this class. So which one is it? Do you throw out the tub with the bathwater? Is that what it is? Baby with the bathwater? Yeah. Yeah. Do we toss out the baby? Yeah. No. Yeah. Hey, let me take the baby over here. Now I'm going to get rid of the bathwater. I gave my dogs a bath yesterday. Got rid of that mamma jamma. That water was dirty. Oh, my gosh. Poor dogs. But I still have the dogs today. We're good. Mm-hmm. Do you get my drift? So, Romans 8, and then we'll close this thing out.
Romans 8 and 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua the Messiah.
Say what? Read that again.
There is therefore now no condemnation.
Do you know what it means to be condemned? We were just talking about condemnation right now. People are condemning homosexuals for who they are because we believe in some stupid principle about a law that don't exist anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But Paul is saying there is therefore now
right.
No condemnation. Read.
To them which are in Yahshua the Messiah.
Now, if you be in Yahshua the Messiah, there is no condemnation of what you're doing physically if you are in Yahshua the Messiah. As the Christians say, amen, right? Come on, really? Read.
Who walk not after the flesh, mm-hmm. but after the Spirit.
If you be in the Spirit, right. we don't care about what you do in your private life. That is just your get down. But if you believe and you are preaching this gospel, that's the only thing that matters.
That's right.
It's the only thing that matters to Yahshua the Messiah. You don't care about all that other stuff. Read.
For the law of the Spirit of life mm-hmm. in Yahshua the Messiah has made me free from the law of sin and death.
So listen. This law makes me free of this law. Mm-hmm. This law was unto his death. This law is unto his resurrection. This law is forever, perpetually in the Spirit. This was a physical law that people did and sacrificed to, that it had to be taken out of the way. Oh, the many sacrifices that died for this law. How many died for this law? I can count one.
Right.
Yep. We can go back to this. It's going to be a whole lot of death. But he said, hey, I'll take it on myself so that you can be free.
Right.
Read.
For what the law could not do, and that it was weak through the flesh.
Wait a second. Weak through what?
Through the flesh.
Because we're our theories, concepts, opinions, which are just temporal, they're corruptible, they're mortal, they die, they change. All that stuff was our fleshly concepts and opinions that we just concocted in our minds. Mm-hmm. But Yahshua made us free of that. Right. Read.
Yahweh sent in his own son mm-hmm. in the likeness of sinful flesh mm-hmm. because of sin to condemn sin in the flesh.
So he said, listen, I'm going to condemn this in the flesh. So he's going to perform it, which he did every jot and tittle mm-hmm. for in 33 and a half years, 4,000 years of people, places, and things in which he set up himself. And then through a man with the Holy Spirit was able to perform that which he instituted. That is amazing. And he condemned it all in the flesh. Mm-hmm. He laughed at them. Like, what are you doing? You really think some water sprinkled on your body is going to change you, cleanse you of yourself? I baptize you in name. What name is that? Lord, Jesus Christ, really? Read.
That the righteousness of the law mm-hmm. might be fulfilled in us mm-hmm. who walk not after the flesh, mm-hmm. but after the Spirit.
I mean, it's like I couldn't have picked a better scripture to follow everything I just said. Mm-hmm. It is not about what you do. You can't do anything to earn this. You can't work upon this. You can't study upon this to get your salvation. There's no internet site to find out, am I saved? www.amisaved.com. No, we're not. There is none of that. Read. I try. Read on.
For they that are after the flesh mm-hmm. do mind the things of the flesh.
That's why we worried about homosexuals, because we are carnal in our minds. We worried about the flesh. Worried about how things look. And he's saying, everyone that does that is of that. Read.
But they that are after the Spirit, mm-hmm. the things of the Spirit. Mm-hmm. For to be carnally minded is death.
So if you're still worried about homosexuals or how you look, or that person used to be a drug addict, or this person up here, you are dying in yourself. To be carnally minded is death. Mm-hmm. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
That's right.
I have peace knowing that, hey, my Redeemer liveth forever because he is a spiritual being. that gave birth to me. Not me, but me.
That's right.
I ain't worried about nothing. Yes, I may lose some money. My business may fail. My kids may grow up to hate me. But that doesn't make me any less saved. Just saying. That's read.
Yeah. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
Read.
Because the carnal mind is at enmity against Yahweh.
That word enmity, the root word is enemy. The carnal mind is at enmity with what?
At enmity against Yahweh.
So, iniquity or carnality is an enmity or at enemies of the righteous spirit. They are contending with each other. The eighth aim is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith, which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh.
Right.
And we are always contending with carnality if we are in the spirit. Mm-hmm. We are always going to fight against that urge to think, does it matter how we look? Did I eat it just because I ate this cookie? I'm going to get a little fat. Right? Like, we're going to always have these issues. We're going to always contend with that. But as long as our focus is on the right thing, our spirituality, do we have the Holy Spirit? That is for you to answer, not for anyone else. It is none of anyone else's business. Read.
For it is not subject to the law of Yahweh,
nope.
And neither indeed can it be.
Mm-mm. No carnality, no flesh and blood cannot enter the kingdom. Mm-hmm. Read.
So then they that are in the flesh cannot mm-hmm. please Yahweh.
So if you up there worried about whether or not I got, you know, a harem of people in my corner, a hermit, whatever I got going on, if you worried about that, you're not pleasing Yahweh. You're only pleasing your flesh. We always judge the next person, right? Because we think we're somebody special. We always think we got something going on, right? Because we used to be here and now we're over there. Here's something I've come to know and learn. There's always someone better than the next person. For every great Glenna, there's a better Glenna. Just letting you know that. Mm-hmm. But guess what? That's my Glenna. Right? That's how we do. There are better classes than this. There are classes that got more money, got more space, got more members, got better equipment. But guess what? This is our class. That's right. We ain't going nowhere. You get what I'm saying? So we don't need to be tripped up about somebody else. This is what we got everything we need here. We got a camera, we got a microphone, we got charts, we got seats, we got lights, air conditioning finally started working. We all good. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Read.
But ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. If so be that the Spirit of Yahweh dwell in you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if any man have not the Spirit of the Messiah, he is none of his. And if the Messiah be in you,
mm-hmm.
the body is dead because of sin. But the Spirit is alive because of righteousness.
Read.
But if the Spirit of him that raised up Yahshua from the dead dwell in you,
mm-hmm.
he that raised up Yahshua from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you.
Read.
Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh
mm-hmm.
to live after the flesh.
Read.
For if ye live after the desires of the flesh,
mm-hmm.
ye shall die.
Mm-hmm.
But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the desires of the flesh, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
they are the sons of Yahweh.
Read.
For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father, mm-hmm. Abba, my Father.
Hold on. 15, start again.
For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear.
To fear. Okay. Today is about, this is for me. This scripture, everything we talking about, this is more for me than you. I just want you to know that. I've been struggling. I mean, just struggling with the death of my father. Everything that I've had troubles with in the last couple years has been because of that. I may appear like I'm good, but I am struggling with this. And so much that I had to go seek help to learn how to grieve. Because you know what? In all my 41 years, I've never had to grieve anyone of significance in my life. I was never close to my grandparents. So there's no real major loss in my mind because I never connected like that.
Right.
I wasn't attached to my father because I had this weird thing that, no. I truly, unconditionally, beyond a shadow of a doubt, love my father. So much that I convinced myself that I can't live without him. I literally stopped living for an entire 2 years because he wasn't here.
Right.
I didn't do things that was healthy for myself. I literally almost let my diabetes kill me, and I just wouldn't go exercise. I didn't want to have real good, healthy relationships. I just didn't want to do anything. And someone said, hey, man, you need to go get some help. You are struggling. Nah, I'm good. I just kept telling me, I'm good. Until I finally, really got someone that, hey, I said, I want this kind of person, this gender, and they need to look like this. I specifically asked for something like that. Because guess what? I look and feel just like that myself. I went to find someone who could relate to who I am. One of the things that he talked to me about was about attachments. There's dismissive attachments. There's attachments that are just about fear. Those are the worst ones. That's the worst. There's the avoidant attachment, and there's a secure attachment. Secure attachment people are just people that just, hey man, you know, these things happen. I love them, but I gotta let them go and move on. And they grieve, they cry, they go through all the stages of grief, and then like, hey man, let's go. And they just start their life again. There's the people who avoid having real connections with people. They do that. You ever play double dutch? You know, do this stuff, right? Right? They in, they out. Then there's those people that attach too much. And then when you get too close, and keep you at an arm's distance, and then they sabotage their relationships with you, right? And then there's the ones that you're always talking about, who Paul's talking about right now. The ones that have the fear. Mm. They have the spirit of fear. Nothing is ever good enough, so why try? I'm not unworthy of love, so you know what? I don't need you. You don't need me. I just ruin your life. That's what he's talking about. We can't have the spirit of fear where we're worried about, you know what? Samuel's better looking in his shoes than mine. You know what? I don't need these shoes. And that's what people do. I wouldn't have believed it until I met someone who's just like that. I was like, you gotta be kidding me. Mm. Paul is saying, hey, you can't have the spirit of fear. That's into bondage. Like, do you know what bondage is? That sucks. It's like just being, just you're a slave to fear. Where you can't operate and move forward because you're afraid to take a step. Do you know what that's like? I'm not going to go down this path because it looks scary. It appears to be scary. But I don't want to go that way either. You know what? That doesn't look too good. I'll just sit right here and hope someone comes and rescues me. That's the spirit of fear. You're always saying, hey, I didn't give you the spirit of fear. I got intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. That strength is supposed to get us from one place to the next. Have the wisdom to know which turns to make. Have enough intelligence to say, hey, you know what? Let me ask a few questions of this before I, you know, accept this. Do you get what I'm saying? He's given us all of this. This is who we are. We don't have it all in totality, but we have a measure of it. Right. So we can try spirits by the spirits and the power of discernment to determine whether or not somebody is worthy of us. Mm-hmm. And guess what? There's no one more worthy than Yahshua Messiah himself. But we up there worried about what someone thinks about us and who's gonna validate us. But we can't validate ourselves. You spend 365 days with yourself a year, but yet you looking for somebody else to make you feel whole. Make sense out of that. Mm-hmm. In Jerry Maguire, I got it, you don't have to bring me down. In Jerry Maguire, there was that scene where it says, "You complete me." And I remember seeing it, I'm thinking, oh, what a great line. Come to find out, that's the worst thing you could tell somebody. You complete me. So now they have control of your completeness. Mm-hmm. Really? let me let you in on a little secret. You will never be whole. Ever. It's never going to happen. Physically so.
Right.
So you can keep looking and seeking and hoping and wishing, but guess what? You will never be whole. It ain't going to happen. Dagnabbit, there's too many losses in your life that you can never fill those holes. You can be the best you can possibly be, but you'll never be whole. Unless this fills you up.
Right.
I'm just being frank with you. There is nothing out there that's going to fill you up save this one. Mm-hmm. So stop looking. Mm-hmm. I literally can't make this up. No physical thing or person can make you whole but you. And that person that you are looking for is Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
If you're looking for something outside of that, you have failed and you failed miserably. You'll never get where you're going. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So, I said in the beginning, the answer is Yahshua Messiah, and I believe at the end, it's still the same. It never stopped being that. I hope and trust you got something that was said on the floor today. Thank you very much. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Williams. That will conclude today's lecture. Thank you all who joined us on Zoom, and thank you to everyone who joined us here in person. Before Dr. Love is out traveling right now. He should be back on Tuesday at latest. Thursday, he's traveling with the family. So, you know, if anybody's wondering where he's at, he's okay. Him and his family are okay. They'll be back soon. No other announcements. Any and all donations can be had by our treasurer, Dr. Eunice Reiser. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies because this is truly the place to learn something about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and power.
Majesty.
I always miss this. Belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha.